and welcome to the seventh Sunday of Easter. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have exalted your only Son, Jesus Christ, with great triumph to your kingdom in heaven. Mercifully give us faith to know that, as he promised, he abides with us on earth to the end of time. He is alive and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our reading today is from the Gospel of John. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
After John had spoken these words, he looked up to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, so that the Son may glorify you, since you have given him authority over all people to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth by finishing the work that you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had in your presence before the world existed. I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you, for the words that you gave to me, I have given to them, and they have received them and know in truth that I come from you, and they have believed that you sent me. I am not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. So before I explore and break open the word that we heard today, I do want to, there's one line that I'm not going to really address, but I think it has to be said. When Jesus says, I am, you know, praying on their behalf, not on the world. Sometimes we just hear that and we think, oh, well, he's only praying for his disciples and nothing else counts. But in that context and the word that was used, it's really talking about everything in, that we would say in the world that is against God. Jesus is praying for all who are not against God. So I just wanted to make that clear. So as we were listening to this, it is Jesus praying for the last time as recorded in the Gospel of John. It's often called the Great or High Priestly Prayer. It's different in the Gospel of John and the other Gospels, you know, at the end before Jesus is betrayed by Judas and taken away, Jesus goes off by himself to pray. But in this gospel, in the Gospel of John, he is with his disciples and they are overhearing him pray, first for himself and then for them. So this Sunday, the seventh Sunday of Easter, we hear the first part of the prayer. In the next 2 years, in year B and C, you'll hear the middle part and the end part. But just so you know, it's a very long prayer. All of the chapter 17, and if you want to read it all, I would encourage that, but just so you know. So in the first 3 or 11 lines of this piece of scripture, we hear the word glorify 5 times. So obviously it's a really important point, and I think we need to look at it and understand what John is meaning. When he says to glorify God, he means to make the presence of God known in the world. It's to draw attention to God and have others see and experience our loving Creator. To glorify God is to mirror His image, which is love, and love in great generosity to the world, just as God does. So keep that in mind as we move forward. This portion of prayer, as I said, is really, we hear 2 parts. The first part is Jesus praying for himself. But as we listen to the words, you know, I think it becomes obvious that Jesus knows his disciples are listening. And so there's some affirmation there and confirmation that the disciples can hear as well. Jesus says, God will glorify him and he will glorify God. He's letting the disciples know that the coming crucifixion is not the end, but it's an opportunity to glorify both the Father and the Son. And Jesus also states that he will return to the Father's presence, that he had been where he had been before the world existed. It's a reminder to the disciples that Jesus came from the Father, and all he has, including, we had heard, his words, and including them, the disciples, is from the Father. And Jesus says in his prayer, I glorified you on earth by finishing the work that you gave me to do. So what is the work that Jesus did? Well, he came so that we would know our loving Creator. He came, as theologian Joy J. Moore says, to reestablish that intimate relationship with the people, with his creation, that was broken with Adam and Eve. He came so that we would know we are precious and loved in the eyes of the Creator. And he came so that we would know that our sins are forgiven. And he came and he died so that we would know we will be with him for eternity. In the second part of the prayer, Jesus is praying for his followers, for those with him and for you and I, for the people that God has given him. Jesus makes it clear that belonging to him is belonging to God. All mine are yours, and yours are mine. And speaking into the future, Jesus says in his prayer, I am coming to you, to the Father. And then he says, Holy Father, protect them so that they may be one as we are one. That's really powerful and comforting and wonderful, all of those things. Jesus prays for us. He prays for our protection and for our connectedness with each other. May they be one as we are one. That's, you know, in our triune God, we have Jesus and God and the Holy Spirit all together as one. And he's saying that's how he wants people to be, that they are that connected. I think Jesus must be a little disappointed in his divided church nowadays. Instead of focusing on our connectedness and our common call to glorify him, we can sometimes get caught up in ways that we do things differently rather than our shared call and mission. If we focused on what was really important, I don't think we would feel the same divisions that we sometimes do. But Jesus knows that we can't do this on our own. We need each other with him and the Creator. And in Acts today, we hear that Jesus promises to send the Holy Spirit to be with us and to help us as well. So together, we're called to glorify God, to make him known in the world. And we do that with each other and with the Father, Son, and Spirit. So what is it, what do we do to make God known in the world? Well, we really only have to look at Jesus and what he did as a guide for us. Throughout Scripture, we are told and we are shown to take care of the poor, the widow, the orphan, and the foreigner in the land. That was consistent through the Old Testament and continued in the New Testament. We're also shown to reach out to the marginalized and the outcast. Jesus continually reached out to those on the periphery, whether it was the hemorrhaging woman, the blind beggar, the leper, prostitute, or tax collector. He showed compassion and mercy to all, even to Judas, who would betray him. Jesus' love had no boundaries. Who are the marginalized in our society now? Who are the ones who need to experience Jesus through our loving encounter with them? In Matthew 25, we're told that we will be judged at the end times. And it won't be for how well we did our jobs or said our prayers. And it won't be about what church we went to or who we knew. It will be if we showed God's love to the hungry and gave them food, to the thirsty and gave them drink, to the stranger and we welcomed them, to the naked and we clothed them, to the sick and we took care of them, to the prisoner and we visited them. For truly I tell you, just as you did this to one of the least of my brothers and sisters, you did it to me. That is how we glorify God, is by doing those things. There are no limits to God's love for us. And we are called to glorify God by sharing without ceasing that love with others. Now, this isn't a new message. I think you've all heard it many, many times. So if we've heard it that often, we must be able to do it, right? Because we're reminded all the time. If you were in the congregation, I'd be asking you to put up your hand if you love every person you encounter in your life with unconditional love. I'm hoping when I say that to my congregation that at least a few people put up their hand, because my hand will be going up. It's hard. It is hard to love some people. And there's lots of things that get in the way. Our own personal hurts and biases. We are protective barriers that we've set up. We also live in a society where there is, a lot of rhetoric that we keep on hearing in politics or judgment on people of different races and religions or even just different viewpoints. There's so much vitriol in the world, it seems to me, and it's only getting worse. And when we see that all the time, and when we hear people being judged all the time, when we're continually told our needs, our desires, our attitudes and opinions are more important than anybody else, it can be hard to hear the words of Jesus. To love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and to love your neighbor as yourself. He says that's the one commandment. We can't separate. We cannot love God with all our hearts and minds and souls if we are not loving our neighbor and ourselves. So the readings today not only give us instruction to glorify God through loving and caring for others, it gives us encouragement. All mine are yours and yours are mine. And Jesus says, I have been, and I will add, will continue to be glorified in them. We're not alone. Our Creator, with His Son and the Holy Spirit, are with us. They care for us, pray for us, and want to be in loving relationship with them and with each other. That's how we glorify God. Thanks be to God.